Good morning. My topic for today is etiology of mood disorder. We should know about the definition of mood disorder. Mood is a pervasive and sustained feeling tone that is experienced internally and that influences the person's behavior and perception of world. And affect is an external expression of mood. Mood can be normal, elevated, or depressed. And these are the classification of disorder of mood: major depressive disorder, persistent depressive disorder, which is dysthymia, cyclothymic disorder, disruptive mood dysregulation disorder, premenstrual dysphoric disorder, bipolar and related disorders, mood disorders due to another medical conditions, substance or medication induced mood disorder. So, unspecified depressive and bipolar related disorder. Biological factors are like biogenic amines, noradrenaline, serotonin, and dopamine, other neurotransmitter disturbances, second messenger and intracellular cascade, alterations of hormonal regulation, thyroid axis activity, growth hormone activity, and prolactin, structural and functional brain imaging, immunological factors and psychological factors. Now we'll see to the noradrenergic system. It plays an initiating and maintaining, it plays a role in initiating and maintaining limbic and cortical arousal as well as modulation of other neuronal system. Noradrenergic projections to the amygdala and hippocampus are implicated in emotional memory and behavioral sensitization to stress and prolonged activation of the locus coeruleus, which contributes to the state of learned helplessness. Medial forebrain bundle is the key ascending norepinephrine pathway to another cortical structures. Stimulation of the medial forebrain bundle elicits increased levels of goal-directed and reward-seeking behavior. Sustained stress eventually results in decreased medial forebrain bundle neurotransmission, which may account for anergia, anhedonia, and diminished libido in depression. Here, regarding the learned helplessness, it is a depressive posture to learn from past situation in which the person was unable to terminate undesirable contingencies. So the model is based on experiments in dogs that were prevented from taking adaptive actions to avoid unpleasant electric shock and subsequently showed no motivation to escape such aversive stimuli when escape avenues were readily available. Martin Seligman postulated a triad of learned helplessness, that is, a belief that it is futile to initiate personal action to reverse aversive circumstances formed from accumulation of past episodes of uncontrollable helplessness. It is potentially useful in understanding such diverse conditions as social powerlessness, defeat in sporting events, and post-traumatic stress disorder. Past events might shape a characterological cluster consisting of passivity, lack of hostility, and self-blame relevant to certain depressive phenomenon. Learned helplessness provide plausible links between aspects of personal biography and clinical phenomenology in depressive disorder. Therapeutic prediction for alleviating the depression and related psychopathological states capitalize on new cognitive strategies geared to modifying expectations of uncontrollability and negative attributional style. Next is serotonin. It projects from the brainstem dorsal raphe nuclei to the cerebral cortex, hypothalamus, thalamus, basal ganglia, septum, and hippocampus. The five HT pathways have inhibitory and facilitatory functions in the brain. Serotonergic neurons projecting to the suprachiasmatic nucleus of the hypothalamus helps to regulate the circadian rhythms like sleep-wake cycle, body temperature, and hypothalamo-pituitary axis function. Inhibits the aggressive behavior across mammalian and reptilian species. Permits or facilitates the goal-directed motor and appetitive behaviors in conjunction with norepinephrine and dopamine. And the acute stress increases the serotonin release transiently, whereas chronic stress will eventually cause decreased serotonin activity and depletion of 5-HT stores. Chronic stress may also increase the synthesis of 5-HT type 1A autoreceptors in the dorsal raphe nuclei, which further decreases the serotonin transmission. Now, elevated glucocorticoid levels tend to enhance the 5-HT functioning and thus may have significant compensatory effects in chronic stress. Dopamine has four pathways: mesolimbic, mesocortical, nigrostriatal pathway. There are four dopamine pathways: the mesolimbic, mesocortical, nigrostriatal, and tuberoinfundibular pathways, of which there is decreased mesocortical and mesolimbic dopamine activities, which is implicated in the cognitive, motor, and hedonic disturbances that are associated with depression. The other neurotransmitters like acetylcholine, which is found in neurons distributed through the cerebral cortex, abnormal levels of choline, which is a precursor to acetylcholine, have been found at autopsy in the brains of some depressed patients, reflecting abnormalities in cell phospholipid composition. GABA has an inhibitory effect on ascending monoamine pathways, particularly the mesocortical and mesolimbic systems. Reduction in GABA have been observed in plasma, CSF, and brain GABA levels in the depression. Second messenger and intracellular cascade. The second messengers regulate the functions of neuronal membrane ion channels, neurotransmitter synthesis and release, and protein kinase activity. Protein kinase catalyzes phosphorylation, an energy liberating process which is involved in the synthesis and degradation of receptors, ion channels, G proteins, and gene transcription and translation factors. That is, abnormalities in platelet adenylate cyclase activity, phosphoinositide hydrolysis, intracellular calcium metabolism, and G protein function in depressive disorder. Alteration in hormonal regulation, the hypothalamo-pituitary axis, which is the hallmark of stress response, and there is clear link between depression and biology of chronic stress. Increased activity is seen in depressed patients, especially in elders. The dexamethasone suppression test, which shows a positive test result indicating the presence of depression. This test represents the hypersecretion of cortisol due to hyperactivity of hypothalamo-pituitary-adrenal axis. 50% of patients with major depression have abnormal levels of dexamethasone suppression test. Diminished release of TSH in response to thyrotropin-releasing hormone is reported in both depression and in mania. The hypocortisolemia in depression suggests one or more of the following central disturbances. That is, there will be decrease in inhibitory serotonin tone, increased drive for norepinephrine, acetylcholine, or cortisol releasing hormone, or decreased feedback inhibition from the hippocampus. There will be increased HPA activity, which is seen in 60% of the depressed patients, especially in elders. A short period of starvation or several weeks of partial sleep deprivation can induce the hypercortisolism in otherwise healthy patients also, sorry, and otherwise healthy people, there is a decreased HPA activity in depression, which can be seen in excretion of urinary cortisol, 24 hours IV collection of plasma cortisol levels, salivary cortisol levels, test of integrity of feedback inhibition. A disturbance of feedback inhibition is tested by the administration of dexamethasone 0.5 to 2 mg, which is a potent synthetic glucocorticoid, which normally suppresses the HPA axis activity for 24 hours. Non-suppression of cortisol secretion at 8 a.m. the following morning or subsequent escape from suppression at 4 p.m. or 11 p.m. is indicative of impaired feedback inhibition. Hypersecretion of cortisol plus dexamethasone non-suppression suggests that there is HPA axis dysfunction. Dexamethasone non-suppression is associated with history of early trauma, which results in reduction in synthesis of glucocorticoid receptors, hippocampal cell death, or chronic hypersecretion of cortisol-releasing hormone. It is also seen in malnutrition, dementia, and 56% of hypothyroidism and depression also shows non-suppression of dexamethasone. Thyroid axis activity. 5-10% of people evaluated for depression have previous undetected thyroid dysfunction, as reflected by an elevated TSH level or an increased TSH response to a 500 mg infusion of the hypothalamic neuropeptide thyroid releasing hormone. Such abnormalities are often associated with elevated antithyroid antibody levels, which is corrected with hormone replacement therapy. Even larger subgroup of depressed patients show a blunted response to TRH challenge, a growth hormone. It is secreted from an anterior pituitary, secreted from the anterior pituitary after stimulation by norepinephrine and dopamine. Secretion is inhibited by somatostatin, a hypothalamic neuropeptide and cortisol releasing hormone. Decreased CSF somatostatin levels have been reported in depression, and increased levels have been observed in mania. Prolactin is released from the pituitary by 5-HT stimulation and inhibited by dopamine. Decreased level of prolactin is seen in depression. Structural and functional brain imaging. MRI is for visualization of brain with high resolution of cortical structures such as hippocampus, anterior cingulate, and white matter. Depression is hyperintensities in subcortical regions like periventricular regions, basal ganglia, and thalamus. In recurrent affective illness, there is ventricular enlargement, cortical atrophy, and sulcal widening. Diffuse and focal areas of atrophy have been associated with increase in cortisol levels and severity of illness. Untreated depressed patients shows hippocampal volume reduction, which measures chronicity of the illness. PET and functional MRI. Normal sadness is associated with increase in blood flow and neuronal activity in thalamus and medial prefrontal cortex, which is non-specific change associated with diverse emotional response. In specific activation is seen in left amygdala, hippocampal formation, and parahippocampal gyrus. Sadness is generated by one's own thoughts. Such cases, there is increased in blood flow to anterior insular cortex. There is decreased anterior brain metabolism, which is more on the left side. Decreased cerebral blood flow and glucose metabolism in regions of dorsolateral prefrontal cortex appears to be severity dependent. Abnormality of regional cerebral metabolism have been observed in unipolar and bipolar depression. Greater the right hemispheric reduction, it is mania. And when there is a left hemisphere reduction is greater, it is depression. Reduction in cerebral blood flow or metabolism are both in dopaminergically innervated tracts of mesocortical and mesolimbic system in depression. Increased glucose metabolism in limbic regions in recurrent depression and family history of mood disorder is correlated by intrusive ruminations. Immunological disturbance is associated with depression. Decreased lymphocyte proliferation in response to mitogens and other forms of impaired cellular immunity. These lymphocytes produce neuromodulators such as CRF and cytokine peptides known as interleukin. They appear to be associated with clinical severity, hypercortisolism, and immune dysfunction. And cytokine interleukin 1 may induce gene activity for glucocorticoid synthesis. Depression is a pro-inflammatory illness, which may partly explain high incidence of comorbid disorders such as obesity, diabetes, and atherosclerosis. Now, coming to psychological factors, life events and environmental factors. The stressful life events results in long-lasting change in brain biology. These long-lasting changes alter the functional states of various neurotransmitters and intraneuronal signaling system. The changes may even include loss of neurons and an excessive reduction in synaptic contacts. As a result, a person has a higher risk of undergoing subsequent episodes of mood disorders, even without external stressor. Personality factors like OCD, histrionic, and borderline are at greater risk. Psychodynamic factors, which is defined by Sigmund Freud and explained by Carl Abraham, involves four key points. Disturbance in mother-infant relationship during oral phase, that is first 10 to 18 months, predisposes to subsequent vulnerability to depression. Depression can be linked to real or imagined object loss. Introjection of departed objects is a defensive mechanism invoked to deal with distress connected with objects loss. Because the lost object is regarded with a mixture of love and hate, feelings of anger are directed inward at self. Cognitive theory, postulated by Aaron Beck, has triad of depression that consists of views about self, which is a negative self-perspective. And about the environment, the patient tend to have experienced the world as hostile and demanding. And about the future, the expectations of suffering and failure. Learned helplessness by Martin Seligman postulated a triad that a belief is futile to initiate, that there is a belief that it is futile to initiate personal action to reverse the aversive circumstances. The learned helplessness theory of depression connects the depressive phenomena to the experience of uncontrollable events. It is useful in understanding diverse conditions as social powerlessness, defeat in sporting events, and post-traumatic stress disorder. These are the references. Thank you.